Joining us today, we have Dr. April Yuki. Dr. Yuki was first an occupational therapist. She doesn't know I'm going to say all this, but I read her bio and I thought it was really interesting. So she was an occupational therapist before she went back to school to become a physician. She enjoyed helping those who had suffered a stroke and other disabling conditions to help regain their independence. So she definitely has a passion for helping people feel their best and get back to that level of independence that they so crave and desire. Medical school had been of interest to her since high school, and after several years of working as an OT, she went back to Indiana University School of Medicine, where she graduated in 2007. She pursued her postdoctoral training through Indiana University School of Medicine with a focus in neurology, and then she completed a fellowship in electrophysiology. And she's board certified through the American Board of Psychiatry and Neurology. She enjoys working with patients who have Parkinson's disease and has a passion for mindfulness and its ability to help both patients and doctors. She enjoys performing a wide variety of procedures, including Botox, with particular interest in cervical dystonia. She's very conscious of the patient's experience and uses a variety of techniques to help patients tolerate an EMG with minimal discomfort and stress. Dr. Yuki has brought some literature with her. It is on the table in the back. If you're interested in learning more, please feel free to stop to pick up that. But without further ado, we're going to go ahead and turn it over to Dr. April Yuki.
So let's just make sure this is at a good height. Everybody can hear me okay? All right. So I'm just gonna see how my thing works here. There we go. So most people may know movement disorders, but many people don't. One of the biggest things that people come to see us for is tremor, but movement disorder, like the name implies, is any abnormal movement. So as we'll talk through the presentation today, you'll see that there are some other common conditions within our realm that are reviewed. So most people, when they see someone with a tremor, think of a particular disease. Any idea what that is? Parkinson's. So that's usually everyone's fear, whether it's them or a family member or they see someone. But there are actually several other things that cause tremor. So Parkinson's disease causes a particular type of tremor and has a series of other features that go with it that we call motor symptoms. It's diagnosed by some specific criteria. We use TRAP as a way to have people remember that. So tremor is the most predominant thing that brings people to the office. But then also there's something called rigidity, which is the muscles are tighter than they should be. And then fancy term of akinesia or bradykinesia, which basically just means slow movements, okay? And then postural instability. So basically that means the person's at risk for falls. And so they need to have various features of this to be considered to have Parkinson's disease. And a movement specialist, many of our diagnoses, like with a tremor, are very visual. So we can see the patient, and oftentimes, before we can even examine them, we have a very good idea of what they may have just from the way it looks. So like I said, there's more than just one type of tremor. The resting tremor is what is kind of the classic feature of Parkinson's. So this is a tremor that occurs when you're just sitting here like you are right now. Could also occur with walking, but doesn't typically occur like when you're drinking from a cup or things like that. It's more when the limb is at rest. And then there's something called a postural tremor, which is kind of when the arms are outstretched, when you're holding a posture of something. And then there's something called an action tremor. So just like it kind of implies, it's a tremor that occurs when you're moving or doing something, like bringing a fork to your mouth or drinking from a cup. And they point towards different conditions. One other tremor that's present, but not as common as these others, is something called a dystonic tremor. And I think this may have a video. If it plays, we'll see. I can't remember if this one does or not. It looks, let me try one other thing. Do you think I have to go out and hit it? Ooh. Okay. That's okay, I can demonstrate. So a dystonic tremor, unlike some of the other tremors which kind of have a regular rhythm to it, it kind of has a very jerky quality to it. It can happen in various places of the body, but is very kind of non-rhythmic and jerky movements of a head or arm, and we'll talk about that in a little further detail about where you might see that. So again, when someone comes for tremor, the most two common things that we're trying to look for is, do they fit in the Parkinson's category? And anatomically, just to provide some background, the Parkinson's disease is related to this structure deep within the brain called the basal ganglia. It is also related to the use of dopamine. And in its simplest form, when it initially starts, you can think about it like a deficiency of a vitamin. So your brain is simply not making enough, and so we can give you dopamine and your motor circuit will work. Essential tremor is the other tremor, and it looks different and it behaves different because different brain structures are involved. So there's this red structure real deep to even the basal ganglia called the thalamus, and then the cerebellum here, which coordinates or fine-tunes our movement. So all of us actually have a tremor. If I hooked up leads to my muscles right now, there would be a tremor there, but we cannot see it, okay? And the cerebellum is what fine-tunes that, so it's not present. And so when that can't coordinate it, it causes the tremor. The dystonic tremor that I mentioned before, which is irregular, does come from that basal ganglia realm, but from a very specific pathway within how it goes out, which is why it's produces such a different symptom, even though it's in the basal ganglia like the Parkinson's disease is. So like I said, we want to initially, most often, try to figure out if someone has Parkinson's or essential tremor. And although we consider them two different things, like everything in life, it's not always that simple, and there is kind of an overlap area. But if you're trying to figure out which it is, essential tremor tends to affect younger people, so 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, but it can affect people older in their 80s or 90s. It's very task specific. So like I said, they're spilling their coffee, they can't get soup to their mouth, they, you know, eyeliner is crooked, you know, so when they're doing an activity is when that tremor is present. Interestingly, this tremor improves with alcohol. So some people self-treat with that, although we don't recommend it. but that can help us determine what kind of tremor it is. If someone tends to drink on occasion and they're able to notice that, that's a feature that tells us, okay, this must be essential tremor. Yeah. So like I mentioned earlier with PD, we have those key features, one of which is the rigidity, the muscle tightness. So interestingly, some people present for Parkinson's disease and their main complaint is shoulder pain. And it's because the rigidity prevents their shoulder from moving, and so it gets kind of stuck or frozen, and it starts to cause pain. And we can tell that different from a joint, again, because of different things on exam, because someone who has a shoulder injury is not gonna have a change in their muscle tone, okay? But if someone comes with joint or shoulder pain, and I can feel this very rigid muscle, they probably don't have a shoulder injury. So I had a patient referred for shoulder pain to do a test called an EMG, which is a way to assess for nerves or things like that. And while I talked to him and I saw him, I said, I don't think this has anything to do with your shoulder. You know, because he had these other rigidity on his exam. The other thing is, changes in writing. The formal term is micrographia, which just means small writing. So if you remember, we said bradykinesia or slow movements, also small movements. So people with Parkinson's, sometimes they'll start out with a good size handwriting, and then you'll notice that it gets smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. That does not happen with essential tremor. Essential tremor, it gets very big and sloppy. So again, Parkinson's can be sloppy, but it's gonna get very small, very different from the other condition. And the other hallmark of Parkinson's is that it responds very specifically to a class of medications that give dopamine. Essential tremor is not gonna respond to that. We still don't have any diagnostic test that can tell us 100% if someone has Parkinson's. So oftentimes a trial of the medication is what helps us know that it is Parkinson's. So here's an example too of some changes in writing that occur with various tremors. You see the essential tremor here, so it's kind of bigger and sloppier. This is actually mild. Sometimes it's all over the page. And then the Parkinson's is kind of smaller than the original one. And then the dystonic tremor. So again, it's not in rhythm. It's very jerky, shaky kind of presentation. So like I alluded to earlier, there are things that cause tremor, some of which are not a neurological condition. So thyroid is something we look at to make sure that they don't have an abnormal thyroid, which might be causing a tremor. Because then if you treat the thyroid, the tremor gets better. They don't need these other medications. Certain medications, the side effect is tremor. So we look at the person's medication list to see whether they're on a medication that might cause a tremor. There's also a very specific class of medications called neuroleptics or antipsychotic medications. They actually cause drug-induced Parkinson's. So their job is to block dopamine to help people with very serious mental illness be able to function. But the downside is they create the symptoms of Parkinson's, the slow movement, the tremor, the rigidity, but it's from the medication. And you can't easily treat that very well by giving them dopamine, because then you're just counteracting their medication. So there are other treatments for that, but that's why we look at that medication list. Liver and kidney disease, because of the toxins, as well as just various treatments like dialysis, will cause a tremor of various kinds. Stress. So sometimes a person has a tremor simply because of stress. We call this kind of enhanced physiologic tremor. So earlier I said like we all have a tremor. So think about maybe a time when you were stressed, or another thing that happens is like if you're really fatigued or had a really big workout, right? You might notice that your arm or hand shakes. And stress specifically causes tremor because basically it puts our nervous system in a very excited tone. So it's just ready to fight or fly away from whatever perceived danger is there. And so the muscles kind of overreact in response to that. And then alcohol, especially long-term alcohol use, because of damage to the brain, can cause a particular tremor, as well as if people are drinking quite a bit and they suddenly stop, there's another type of tremor that can occur related just to alcohol use in excess. So this slide is here to emphasize that although there may be some chronic conditions with Parkinson's or essential tremor, that the medication the doctors prescribe are really just a small portion of how these diseases can be managed and treated. Even with Parkinson's, which we know the brain damages over time, one of the key things for treatment of that disease is physical exercise. And in fact, initially when someone's diagnosed, studies show that physical exercise is just as effective as the dopamine medication is. So many people, I think, don't necessarily believe us when we tell them that. But it's very true. So if you know someone with Parkinson's or have a family member with Parkinson's, you know, if they're not moving or exercising or doing any activities, if you can help them find ways to motivate themselves, it will have a huge impact on their disease course. So now I'm going to switch a little bit over to the dystonias. This is another prominent movement disorder, but is not very well known by the public. So probably the most obvious one is something called cervical dystonia. And this is where the head can be pulled in various positions, and it's due to that muscle being overactive. And sometimes there's a tremor because there's an overactive muscle on the other side and they're fighting each other. So this condition can be very painful. And the primary treatment for it is actually Botox therapy. So other places that this can occur is like in an arm. Writer's cramp there at the bottom is actually a form of dystonia. You know, it's not something that happens once or twice for these people. It happens virtually every time they pick up a pen or a pencil. And then above that, you'll see musicians. So musicians' dystonia is where they develop an overactivation of the muscles that they typically use, and it prevents them from playing in a particular way. And so behavioral therapy or braces or various things can help them. It's a little harder sometimes to use Botox in either of these conditions because we don't want to weaken muscles too much that would affect the actual function. So usually the musician one is done through behavioral retraining of the muscles. Hand dystonia, again, sometimes you might use different pens or different things, but sometimes we do actually do some injections for that too. So the other one, it's called spasmodic dysphonia. Now this may or may not play, let's see. So listen.
I have the rare aversion, the AB or the abductor version. My vocal cords stay open rather than open and shut, and I sound breathy quite frequently.
So
a shade mystically crossed.
See if I can get that. So I think you could all appreciate that her speech was not normal. If you're an NPR listener, Diane Reams also has spasmodic dystonia. And this is treated with Botox. This is treated with Botox once every 3 months. Let's see if it's going to move on now. There we go. So I talked a little bit earlier about how Botox there on the right can be a possible treatment, bracing at the top, and then behavioral relearning there is shown kind of on the bottom as treatment methods for these conditions. So I'm going to move on now to a much less known condition, at least for most people, called Huntington's disease. Has anyone in the room here actually heard of this condition? Okay, so actually more than I expected. One way to think of this horrible disease is like someone has Alzheimer's. So memory impairment and things like that, as well as having a condition called ALS, okay, muscle weakness, if you remember the ice bucket challenge, and Parkinson's disease, all together in one. It's a very devastating disease. And it's genetic. It's passed down from one generation to the next. It's a repeat of this particular gene, and if there's more than 40, you have the condition. So every child of someone who has Huntington's has a 50% chance of having the disease themselves. The extent to which it's expressed depends on how many repeats you have. So if you have 45, you probably have pretty mild symptoms. If you have 150, it's going to be not good. So features of this is another type of movement called chorea, along with personality changes, trouble swallowing, slurred speech, and then, like I said, kind of the memory issues on top of that. We'll see if this plays.
You should be able to make it big.
So you can see how devastating that condition is for even very young people. Because again, the more the duplicate, usually the younger onset of the condition as well.
So. You have the gene? And your spouse have the gene? And you not know it?
No, it's autosomal dominant sense, so if you have the gene, you have the condition.
Thank you.
All right, so moving on to a less tragic condition is Tourette syndrome. Ooh, let me get this large again. So this is actually a condition usually diagnosed in childhood, or at least by the age of 20. Most people think of it, you know, seen it in comedy movies where people are swearing or things like that. But these can also just be different motor tics. You know, sometimes it looks like someone's just shrugging their shoulders, or they might blink their eyes a lot, or various things. Those are motor tics. But what a lot of people don't know, like this picture shows, is that that's only what you can see. These people generally have a lot of other associated issues. So down here, sleep, attention deficit, with or without hyperactivity, various learning disabilities, obsessive compulsive disorder, sometimes autism spectrum disorders. So there's a lot more to it than just the movement part that we see. So another condition that's a movement disorder is something called tardive dyskinesia. There are various signs of this. Mainly, it's most obvious by some mouth movement. So very particular kind of mouth movements that someone doesn't have control over. This is typically a side effect of medications as well. However, again, these people typically can't be taken off this medication because they need it to function mentally. And so then we have to find ways to treat it. But it can have other factors, like it mentioned, some difficulty breathing or swallowing or other movements, but those are less common. So again, I just touched briefly on several movement disorders, the most prominent there with the tremors to initiate, but there are various other syndromes. There are Parkinson's-like syndromes. They are listed at the bottom. Sadly, those have a worse prognosis than standard Parkinson's. Also, I'll point out functional movement disorders. So again, this is actually kind of related to stress. So people who haven't managed their stress, instead of having a heart attack, they get abnormal movements or a tremor or various movements, but it's not related to any anatomical or other structural functional. It's management of stress. So that brings me to the end of my presentation. My understanding is that there are index cards on each table. So if you have a particular question, we would like to ask you to write it down, and they'll be brought to the front so that I can read them, so those who are seeing this in the recording and such can hear the question and the response. So we'll give you a couple minutes here to kind of write down any questions that you have. So I'll go ahead and proceed with the first question here, but feel free if you have one to continue to write and to bring it up. So this is from someone who has a spouse with Parkinson's, who indicates that they actually do have tremors when they're doing something such as feeding and such, which can happen typically a little later in the course versus presentation. And sometimes those people can, if the medication is not sufficient to dampen down the tremor, will work with occupational therapy or on their own sometimes to find alternative cups or forks or spoons or plates that can sometimes help. But it can be challenging. It's not uncommon that at some point people have to have someone cut up their food, but then they can still feed themselves. But sometimes a plate with a rim can help them feed themselves longer because they can push the food up against it, even though they're shaking, so that it doesn't fall off the plate. But that's that would be a good way to talk to your doctor to request an occupational therapy evaluation, who could look at the person specifically and see what adaptations are there if the medication has been maximized. So one question is, how is cervical dystonia different than torticollis? So it's a little bit semantics. We typically refer to torticollis as the condition that occurs with children, which goes away as they age. But technically, cervical dystonia is a form of torticollis. It's just a difference of language. And in medicine, like I said, we kind of reserve that for children versus adults. The other question is cerebellar ataxia related to cerebral palsy? And the answer is no. Cerebellar ataxia is actually a group of genetic conditions that usually develops later in life, anywhere from midlife to older age, and presents with difficulty with precise movement, but it's not really a tremor. But it can also affect balance because of that and a variety of other symptoms. Another question is, how do you manage falling down? So I'm assuming this person or someone they like or love has probably Parkinson's, because like we talked about, postural instability is a large factor for them. So again, making sure they're doing regular activity. which includes balance exercises. So balance is really a complex muscle, okay? So just like a muscle, we can strengthen it, right, by lifting weights, and then it becomes easier to lift things that are heavier. So balance exercises can help maintain balance. It may not always regain balance, but the idea is to prevent that. So that's why like things like Rock City Boxing or Tai Chi or other things have been found to be very helpful. But it doesn't have to be those formal things. It can be simple, you know, exercises at home, trying to stand on one foot, or if that's too complex, even standing at the walker with only one hand on or two, you know, both hands off. So again, sometimes physical therapy specific for that, proper use of walkers or canes. So oftentimes, I would say most of the time when I'm out in public, people are not using their walkers or their canes appropriately. So, you know, putting it over here and then walking three steps to your chair is not appropriate use for a walker. That's usually when the person falls. Also thinking about time of day. So nighttime is a high risk area. Bathrooms are a high risk area. So looking at potentially ways to avoid that, either by, you know, having a urinal or bedside commode, or, you know, making sure there's grab bars and supports wherever you can possibly get it. And again, physical therapy, occupational therapy can sometimes be helpful with various aspects of that. So Juan says, what tests help with the diagnosis? So most of the tests we do for any of these conditions, the test purpose is not to diagnose that particular condition, but to rule out other conditions. So say Parkinson's, if we decide to obtain an MRI of the brain, we're looking for things like strokes, tumors, to be present as the cause of the symptom. And so when it's negative or a normal MRI, then we continue to be concerned about Parkinson's. There is an advanced testing now done called a DAT scan. And this can tell us and help us differentiate essential tremor from Parkinson's in the sense of it will show dopamine dysfunction. But the problem is that, like I mentioned earlier, there are Parkinson's-like syndromes, there's medication-induced Parkinson's, and they will all have an abnormal DAT scan. So that helps us know kind of which camp they're in. It doesn't tell us specifically the disorder that they have. That's really related to the clinical aspect of the symptoms that the person has. So then, another question was, are there recommendations for someone who blinks a lot in conversations? So if it is a tic, you know, there are treatments with medications. Sometimes though with tics, they are able to do some behavioral training through therapy to find different tricks that can help the person avoid that. But sometimes it doesn't make it go away 100%. So there aren't necessarily good, quick answers for that. And then there's a question about treatment for something like a Charlie horse versus the rigidity. And yeah, so a Charlie horse is really a muscle cramp, which is definitely kind of in a different realm. And honestly, in the medicine world, I mean, we don't have any medications to treat that. You know, the standard recommendation is exercise, stretching, drinking enough fluids, things like that. But even then, you know, some people cramp more than others. And we really haven't come up with great solutions for that yet.
Let's give Dr. Yuki a round of applause.